Good evening. Welcome to the United Methodist Church of the Resurrection and the Resurrection Lectureship Series. We're really glad that you came tonight. I want to just ask a quick question. How many of you are members of Resurrection? Raise your hand if you would. Awesome. I'm so glad you're here tonight. Thank you so much. How many of you are here from the Leadership Institute? Raise your hands. All right. Excellent. Excellent. So, Resurrection members, meet the Leadership Institute people and vice versa. Why don't you take a second, stand, and find out where the folks are from and what their names are. Let's welcome one another.
Just gone through the motions, I'm sorry.
All right, have a seat. I'd like to take a moment to welcome all of you who are joining us online as well. Thank you so much for those of you who are joining us on our Church of the Resurrection website, those of you who are joining us on Facebook or by other means. We're really glad that you're joining this evening as well. Those of you who are in the room should have received one of these little handouts when you came in. Did you get one of those? All right, and on the back side, there's a place to take notes. You will fill this up, I'm pretty confident. And if you're at home, you might want to have a pen and paper handy because I believe you're really going to be blessed and you're going to be wanting to take notes and try to remember things. You'll be writing as fast as you can. We had a chance to hear David speak earlier this afternoon, and it was just extraordinary, and I know that you're going to be blessed this evening as well. I want to tell you a little bit about our speaker tonight. Many of you know him already. How many of you, by the way, read David Brooks' columns, books? You've seen him on TV. Okay, so almost everybody's familiar, but I'm going to tell you maybe a few things you didn't know. David Brooks is of course, he's the op-ed columnist for the New York Times. He's a commentator on PBS NewsHour, NPR's All Things Considered, and NBC's Meet the Press. He's the executive director of the Aspen Institute. He's a faculty member at Yale University, a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. He has served as an editor at Newsweek, The Atlantic Monthly. He wrote for The Washington Times and The Wall Street Journal and a whole host of other places. He's had articles published in The New Yorker, The New York Times Magazine, Forbes, Washington Post, and many, many more. He's been a visiting professor at all kinds of different places. He speaks across the country, and he's written two of the best books that I have ever read. This book is probably one of my all-time favorite books, The Road to Character by David Brooks. It's available in the Narthex right after this is over. His latest book is The Second Mountain, The Quest for a Moral Life. It's an extraordinary book. I'm halfway through the first half on Audible, and then I started doing what my wife does, and I started reading the back half before I finished the first half, and I bought the book. So I bought two copies of your book now, David, and I'm really grateful to have a chance to do that. He'll be signing books immediately following out in the Narthex, so we'd love to invite you to stick around afterwards if you'd like to meet him and have your book signed. So this evening, we have a chance to hear a remarkable thinker and speaker. We're going to have a chance to allow him to pour into our lives, to share with us a vision of the second mountain. So I'd like to invite you to bow with me in prayer, and then we're going to greet our guest speaker. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to be here together. We thank you that David Brooks is here and that he's given his time to invest in us today. We pray that you would renew his strength. He's already been speaking this afternoon and connecting with people. We pray you would renew his strength, allow him to feel your pleasure as he's speaking to us. And we pray that you would give us ears to hear and our hearts to receive all that you have for us tonight. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Would you give a warm Church of the Resurrection welcome to David Brooks?
Thank you. So this is my second talk here, and I was reminded, I recorded my first book called Bobos in Paradise on tape. And when you read a book aloud for the on-tape version, you realize how boring your book is, because you have to read aloud all the boring parts. But I did get a story out of that. My sound engineer had just recorded a novelist who'd written a 700-page novel that he had to read aloud in the sound studio. And in the middle of the process, the sound engineer saw the novelist weeping in the booth. And so he pushed his button and he said, "Is there something I can do for you?" And the novelist said, "Don't I ever shut up?" And so I'm a bit in that position right now, but I'll shut up in about an hour. So I'm going to tell you two stories tonight, and they're stories about myself, but I hope you'll find resonance in them. And the first story is the external story, the things, the way life looks like from the outside. And then the second story is the internal story, how life looks inside. Now, the external story, my external story is very fortunate, very blessed, and pretty direct line. I was born in Toronto, but really grew up in Lower Manhattan in New York City. When I was five, my parents, who were somewhat left-wing, took me to a thing called a bee-in, which is where hippies would go just to be. And one of the things they did was they set the garbage can on fire and threw their wallets into it to demonstrate their liberation from money and material things. And I was five, and I saw a $5 bill on fire in the garbage can, so I broke from the crowd, reached into the fire, and ran away. And that was my first step over to the right. And then I, when I was seven, I read a book called Paddington the Bear and decided at that moment I wanted to become a writer. And it's been 50 years now. I've been pretty much writing every day, but maybe 200 since. And I remember writing became the center of my value system. I remember in high school I wanted to date this woman named Bernice, and she didn't want to date me. She dated some other guy. And I remember thinking, what is she thinking? I write way better than that guy. And so this is the core of who I was. But so I was already kind of a cerebral person, a bookish person. And then when I was 18, the admissions officers at Columbia, Wesleyan, and Brown decided I should go to the University of Chicago. And my favorite saying about Chicago is, it's a Baptist school where atheist professors teach Jewish students St. Thomas Aquinas. And so it's a pretty studious school. The students wear these t-shirts that say, sure, it works in practice, but does it work in theory? And I was studious there. I had a double major in history and celibacy at Chicago. My big break came when William F. Buckley came to campus. And he was then one of the most prominent columnists in the country. And he, as he came, I was a columnist for the school paper, so I wrote a vicious parody of him for being a sort of a name-dropping blowhard. It was jokes like, when Buckley was at Yale, he formed two magazines, one called the National Buckley, one called the Buckley Review, which he merged to form the Buckley Buckley, is that kind of thing. And so he came to campus and delivered a speech, and at the end of the speech, he said, he must have found their parody funny, because he said, "David Brooks, if you're in the audience, I want to give you a job." And that was literally the big break of my life. Now, sadly, I was not in the audience. I was actually, had been hired by PBS to go to Stanford and to debate Milton Friedman. It was a show where Milton talks to college students. And you can go on YouTube right now, and if you type in David Brooks Milton Friedman, you'll see a 21-year-old version of me in these gigantic 1980s glasses that apparently were on loan from the Mount Palomar Lunar Observatory. The show is basically, I make some point that I've read in some textbook, Friedman destroys it in about six words, and then the camera lingers on my face for 19 or 20 seconds as I try to think of something to say. That was the show. Then my career was pretty much straight line up. I called Buckley 3 years later, said, "Is that job offer still open?" And he said yes, and he became my mentor for 18 months, and then he sent me off into the world. And I made it to the Washington Times, then I was on the Wall Street Journal, and I have to say, since where we are, that the Wall Street Journal was my first real experience with Midwesterners. I don't think Chicago really counts. So I was working with a bunch of guys who were farm boys from Indiana and Iowa, mostly, and they gave reticence. I'm not the most talkative person on earth, but they gave reticence a whole new level. So editorial meetings were a bunch of guys sitting straight, staring at the wall, not looking at each other. It was like an open casket funeral with 13 bodies spread around. And being a New Yorker, I had to sit in my chair and stare at my shoes and say to myself, I will not break this silence. I will not break this silence. So I stayed at the Journal, and then I had a bunch of lucky opportunities. And about 18 years ago, I was hired to be a conservative columnist of the New York Times, which is a job I likened to being the chief rabbi at Mecca. Not a lot of company there. And then I got hired to do a show on PBS called The News Hour with Mark Shields. We have a segment called Shields and Brooks. We wanted to call it Brooks Shields. That would have been better, but thank you. Yeah, Mark has been doing it a little while. It's now Shields and Brooks. Before there was that, it was Shields and Gigo. Before that, it was Shields and Gergen. Before that, it was Shields and Coolidge, I think. Started out, I think, Shields and Machiavelli. Goes back a little ways. But we have a very lovely audience and a somewhat older audience. We call them seasoned youth. So if a 93-year-old comes up to me in the airport, I know what she's going to say. I don't watch your show, but my mother loves it. And then I started writing books. And as I've gotten older, I think I've gotten more sensitive. I'm the only American man to finish the book Eat, Pray, Love, if you remember that book. By age 123, I was actually lactating, which was a surprise. And then I wrote Road to Character and Second Mountain. And I learned writing Road to Character that writing a book on character doesn't give you good character. And even reading a book on character doesn't give you good character. But buying a book on character does give you good character. So. And so that's the external story of my life. It's pretty simple, and it's very lucky. It's straight up. The internal is a little different. So about a year ago, or maybe a year and a half ago now, I went back and reread Paddington the Bear. And it's a very sad book. It's about a pair who comes from Peru to London, has nobody, and he's lost at a train station with no family. And finally, a family sweeps him in. And so I was thinking, what kind of sad kid was I that this really hit me so hard? And then as I was reading it, I remember the intensity of that first experience, that experience that prefigured a lot of what would come later. And I think as children, we somehow feel that intensity more often than we do as an adult. And for me, that seven-year-old experience was what I call in the book an annunciation moment. One of those moments that prefigures a lot of what is going to come later in your life. And a lot of fortunate people have moments either early in life or late in life where suddenly it clicks and they know what they're going to do. One of my heroes is a scientist named E.O. Wilson, and he was living in Alabama, and his family was splitting up, getting a divorce, and they shipped him away one summer to a place called Paradise Beach in Florida and had him stay with a family he did not know. And he didn't want to hang around the family, so he went out on the beach every day. And he'd never seen a beach before. And he explored it, and he found creatures he had never imagined before, a jellyfish. Imagine seeing a jellyfish for the first time. He was sitting on the dock one day, and a stingray slid beneath his feet. And at that moment, he said, I was thunderstruck, and a naturalist was born. He was losing one world, but he found another world in the ocean that was beautiful, and he was entranced by it. And so that was a moment, sometimes we discover something at a moment of loss. And what's interesting to me about those moments is how aesthetic they are. You see something beautiful, and you're just drawn to beauty. The Greek word for beauty is call, it calls forth. My daughter, when she was five, she walked into a hockey rink and immediately felt at home. She's 26 now, she works for the Anaheim Ducks, a hockey team out in California, teaching young people to play hockey. And she's had that her whole life. When Einstein was four, his father gave him a compass, and the little kid saw the invisible forces of the universe moving the needle, and he spent the rest of his life thinking about those invisible forces. Somebody asked a painter, why did you become a painter? And she said, I love the smell of paint. It's aesthetic. Nietzsche says, if you want to find out the law of your very nature, list out the four most beautiful moments of your life and see if you can draw a thematic line through them. And that's how you'll find yourself. So there was one more chapter in E.O. Wilson's annunciation moment. He was out fishing that same summer, toward the end of the summer, and he caught a fish, and he was careless as he took it off the hook, and it flopped into his face, and the tail fin poked his retina. And he should have gone inside, but he didn't want to leave the ocean, so he stayed out and eventually lost vision in that eye. So he couldn't study, it could be a naturalist, but he couldn't study anything that required two-eye stereoscopy. So birds were out, fish were out, but he could hold up ants to his one good hand. And he became an ant scientist and later just a general scientist. And sometimes it's a blessing to have some options closed off. And after that intensity of finding who you are, the other intensity that children have is the capacity to admire and even idolize. I remember when I was a kid, I looked up at teenagers like they were gods. And we all have mentors. For me, it was Buckley. For others, somebody we just deeply admire and who shapes us. For Wilson, it was a guy named Philip Darlington, who was a professor of entomology at Harvard. And Darlington taught him, the way you do our craft is the hard way. When you're collecting bug samples, don't collect on the path, cut through the jungle. And when the famous story about Darlington, he was collecting samples in the Amazon. He was floating on a log on a pond, collecting his samples. And a crocodile came up from the bottom of the pond, grabbed him, ripped him down to the bottom of the pond. He escaped, got up to the top. He got ripped down back to the bottom and escaped again. His whole right side of his body was shredded, and he got back to camp and to safety. But that wasn't what impressed E.O. Wilson. Anybody can escape a crocodile. What impressed him was that in a full body cast, with his right arm immobilized, he taught himself to go into the jungle and collect his samples left-handed for months. And I think that's what young people want. We think young people want happiness, but they want intensity. They want to be taught that something is hard, but is worthy of the hardness. And I think if we look back on the mentors who really affect us, they weren't always the kindest to us. Sometimes they were demanding in the context of love. And so that's the intensity of youth. But sometimes that intensity gets covered over by our culture. The first thing we do is we take young, desiring, ardent people, and we run them through the college admissions process, which teaches them that status and achievement are the core of life. And then we surround them in the culture of the meritocracy. And that culture creates a lot of achievement, but it is also based on a bunch of lies. The first lie it tells is career success can make you happy. And I'm the poster child for that not being true. The second lie it tells you is I can make myself happy. If I just get better at my job, get better at something else, then I'll make myself happy. But the people who are really happy are not self-sufficient. They are utterly dependent on other people. The third lie is you can find your own truth. Everybody should have their own viewpoint, their own moral vocabulary, their own way of looking at the world. Well, if your name is Aristotle, maybe you can do that. The rest of us need help. And truth comes from outside us. It's not generated within us. And if you detach people from any external truth, you've detached them from a sense of meaning and purpose in their lives. So the final lies are just the generic atmosphere of the meritocracy. The emotion of the meritocracy is conditional love. You have to achieve to be loved, and you win love by achievement. The sociology of the meritocracy is society is divided to the inner ring, where the successful people are, and people on outer rings, hungering to get in. The anthropology of the meritocracy is you're not a soul to be saved, you're a set of skills to be maximized. And the ultimate lie, as I mentioned earlier today, is that people who have achieved more are worth a little more than everybody else. And if you want to destroy your society, that's a pretty good lie to introduce into. And so what the meritocracy does is it numbs us. First, it buffers us off from each other, and then it numbs us. And I told the story of this Israeli daycare center where they had a problem because the parents were coming in late. And they decided to impose fines on the parents who came late to pick up their kids. And the number of people who came in late doubled. Because what had once been an emotional relationship and a moral responsibility to the teacher to come on time so they can get a home was turned into an economic transaction. And the moral lens was taken off and the economic lens was put on. And we do that a lot in our culture. And so one of the things our culture creates is a sense of disconnection. And as a writer, I already start in some place of disconnection. Writing is and journalism in particular, is often for those who are a little detached from the world. I tell my journalism students, if you're at a football game and everybody else is doing the wave and you don't do the wave, you just sit there, you have the right kind of aloof personality type to be a journalist. Because we don't actually do anything, we just watch other people do things. And then the act of writing is itself very lonely. You're alone all the time. John Cheever was a writer in New York. He would get up in the morning, he would put on his only suit and tie, he'd ride the elevator of his building down to the basement where he had an office, he would take off his suit and tie, he would write in his boxers, then at 12:30 he'd put on the suit and tie, he'd ride the elevator back up and make himself lunch. And that's the routine that he had, but it was all alone. My routine is 7 to noon every morning, writing in my office, and I used to wear a Fitbit, and the Fitbit was recording me. It said, you're asleep between 7 and noon every morning. And all I can think of is that my heart rate was going down, so it thought I was asleep, but I was writing. And then if you achieve success, it gets more lonely still. I mentioned earlier today that my last book tour, I was on the road for 99 consecutive days, and at one point counted 42 consecutive meals eaten alone at an airplane, airport, or hotel. And when you're detached from all your sources of affection, and you're just alone on the road, your whole mind goes wobbly. And I saw a picture of Britney Spears had went berserk and shaved off all her head hair. And I thought, yeah, I could do that. I'm about close to that. And so you sort of get sucked up in a certain culture that we have here. And I got sucked into a culture where I desired reputation a lot. I came to idolize time. I came to value productivity over people. And I had a lot of constituencies I had to serve all the time, so I had a little clock on my head, gotta keep moving, gotta keep moving. If I'm with somebody, I'm thinking about the person, next person I gotta keep moving and be committed to. And if you prioritize time over people, you're not building a real relationship. And if you're trying to control your life rather than be controlled by the circumstances you're in, you're not really in relationship. And so the wages of sin are sin. And in 2013, my kids had left home or were leaving home for college. My marriage had ended. A lot of my friends had been in the conservative movement, and I was not that kind of conservative anymore. And so a lot of those social connections faded away. And so I was detached. I was living alone in an apartment. I wasn't inviting anybody over, and nobody was inviting me. So I had weekday friends who I could talk politics about. I didn't have weekend friends, which are the real kind. And if you came into my apartment and opened the drawer where there should have been silverware in the kitchen, there were post-it notes. And if you opened the drawer where there should have been plates, there was stationery. Workaholism is a very good way to try to distract yourself from any spiritual or emotional crisis. And so I was just trying to work my way through, but I was really suffering from a crisis of solidarity, a crisis of isolation. And the weird thing was, as I was going through this crisis, a lot of Americans were going through this crisis. I always say I'm an average American with above average communication skills. So if I'm going through something, it's probable that a lot of people are. And so we have had 60 years of individualism, and it's left not only me, but a lot of us, a little detached from others. 35% of Americans over 45 say they're chronically lonely. A generation ago, only 8% of Americans lived alone, now 30% live alone. Only 8% of Americans say they have important conversations with their neighbors. The fastest growing political party is unaffiliated. The fastest growing religious movement is unaffiliated. Since 1999, the suicide rate is up by 30%. Among teenagers, the suicide rate since 2011 is up 70%. 45,000 Americans kill themselves every year through suicide. 72,000 die from opiate addiction. The lifespan is declining, not rising. And it's all caused by social dislocation, isolation, disconnection. If you ask Americans, do you trust the people around you? A generation ago, the vast majority have said, yeah, my neighbors are trustworthy. Now 32% of Americans say their neighbors are trustworthy, and only 19% of millennials. So as I was going through a valley, the country was going through a valley, and it was a valley of lack of relationship, a valley of disconnection. Fortunately, the Greeks say you suffer your way to wisdom. And so I learned some things in the valley. The first thing I learned was that freedom sucks. Political freedom is good, economic freedom is pretty good, social freedom is not good. All my married friends were projecting their fantasies onto me. Oh, you should travel the world, you should be a swinger. It's like, no. The person who is unattached and uncommitted and free is also unremembered, because you're not really attached to anything. You're sort of loose. And so I learned that that freedom is not the kind of freedom you want to have, just the absence of social restraint. The second thing I learned is that you can be broken or you can be broken open. That some people turn fragile, they hate the pain and the grief that those all of us who have had valley moments have had, and so they make themselves impregnable. And you can never really touch them, and they can never really touch you. And those people are broken. And brokenness often takes the form of tribalism. If you leave human beings naked and alone, they do what their evolutionary roots tell them to do, they revert to tribe. And as I said today, tribalism seems like community, but it's the opposite of community. Community is based on a mutual love for our place or something, and tribalism is based on the common hatred for some other. It's a scarcity mentality. An abundance mentality is predicated on the idea that life is a garden. A scarcity mentality, it's a desert, and we're going to scramble for resources. And so it's always war, it's always distrust, it's always attack before it be attacked, it's always the ends justify the means. And that's a way you can be broken. But other people get broken open. They smash the shell of their ego, smash the shell of the life they thought they were going to live. And suddenly in the valley, the ambitions, the ego ambitions of the first part of their life just don't seem that important. And they're ready for a bigger and more vulnerable and open life. And they go deeper into themselves than they ever went before, and they discover what has been lying there all along. The first thing they discover is their own heart and the desires of the heart. Now, not long ago, I read about a guy who bought a house that had a driveway and then a bamboo stand next to the driveway. And he hated bamboo, so he chopped down the bamboo stand. He took an axe to the root system. He dug a 3-foot hole. He filled it with plant poison, gravel, and 6 inches of concrete. 2 years later, little shoot of bamboo coming up to the bottom. And in my view, we all have that inside ourselves, which is our desire. We are desiring creatures more than we're thinking creatures. And what our desire, what the heart desires, is some sort of common connection with other people. And what it ultimately desires is complete fusion with another person. The kind of fusion that Louis de Bernier, the novelist, described in his book, Captain Corelli's Mandolin. In that book, he's got an old guy talking to his daughter about his relationship with his late wife. And the old guy says, "Love itself is what is left over when being in love is burned away. And this is both an art and a fortunate accident. Your mother and I had it. We had roots that grew towards each other underground, and when all the pretty blossoms had fallen from our branches, we discovered that we are one tree and not two." And that's what we want. And the lucky people get that. And so that's one set of desires you certainly become aware of, and you're not going to ignore your heart. The second thing you find is the soul. Now, I'm a secular writer and author, so I don't preach to audience whether they should believe in God or not believe in God. That's his job. I just asked everybody to understand that they do have a soul, that there's some piece of you that has no size, shape, color, or weight, but gives you infinite value and dignity. Rich and successful people don't have more of this than poorer people. Old people don't have more of this than younger people. Slavery is wrong because it's an attempt to obliterate another soul. Rape isn't just an attack on a bunch of physical molecules, it's an attempt to insult the soul. And what our souls, the first thing they do is they give us our equality. Our mental abilities are not equal, our physical abilities are not equal, but our souls are equal. And the second thing the soul does is it yearns. It yearns for righteousness. I've interviewed a lot of bad people in my journalistic career who committed crimes and rapes and genocides. I've never met one who didn't want to be good. They all have some rationalization for why the bad thing they did was actually a good thing. So everyone yearns to be good. Everyone learns to be committed and to live for some ideal and to taste the moral transcendence that people who have worked toward an ideal sometimes feel. What Rabbi Wolf Kalman felt on the bridge on the March to Selma with Martin Luther King, he later wrote of that experience. We felt connected in song to the transcendental, the ineffable. We felt triumph and celebration. We felt that things change for the good and nothing is congealed forever. That was the warmest, most transcendental spiritual experience. Meaning and purpose and mission were beyond exact words. Meaning was the feeling, the moment of overwhelming spiritual fulfillment. And people who are working towards some good sometimes feel themselves lost in that good. They understand, as Steinbeck wrote, that humans are caught in their lives and in their thoughts in a moral drama. At the end, all that matters is the clean questions, is how he put it. Did you do well or ill? Did you serve a great God or not? And that led to the third realization, which is a formula from Einstein, is that the problem you created is not going to be solved on the same level of consciousness at which you created it. You have to rise to a bigger level of consciousness. And I quoted my favorite line in the whole book, which is from a friend of mine named Catherine Cox, who said that when my daughter was born, I realized I loved her more than evolution required. And when you go deep in yourself, you find this ability to care and love more than makes sense. Annie Dillard wrote, "In the deeps are the violence and terror of which psychology has warned us. But if you ride these monsters deeper down, if you drop with them further over the world's rim, you find what the sciences cannot name, the substrate, the ocean or matrix, which buoys all the rest, which gives goodness its power for good and evil its power for evil, our complex and inexplicable caring for each other." I just emphasize that last line, our complex and inexplicable caring for each other. You tap into that magic, you've got a wider and more enchanted view of life. And the fourth thing I learned is that when you're in the valley, you can't pull yourself out of the valley. Somebody has to reach down and pull you out. And you have to rely on somebody else. You have to fall into somebody else. And I had a fortunate thing happen to me when I was in my valley period. I got invited over to the house of a couple named Kathy and David. And I was accepting invitations at that time. And they had a kid in the DC public schools named Santi, and Santi had a friend named James, whose mom had some health and other issues. And so often James had no place to sleep and nothing to eat. So they said, James can live with us. And so James came over and stayed with them. And then James had a friend, and that kid had a friend, and that kid had a friend. And soon there were 40 kids around the dinner table and 15 sleeping around. And so I walk in that first day, and I reach out my hand to shake a kid's hand. And the kid, who's this charismatic young man, goes like this, and he says, "We don't really shake hands here. We just hug here." And I'm not the huggiest guy on the face of the earth. But I've been at that table ever since, hugging those kids every Thursday night. And what we offered them was an audience so they could display their talents. What they offered us was emotional transparency. They turn at you and beam like flowers looking for love, and you have no choice but to beam and be transparent back. And in Washington, D.C., and sometimes in the Midwest, where I often say Washington is the most emotionally avoidant city on the face of the earth, but they force you to be there. I took my daughter the first time she went there, she came out, and she said, "That's the warmest place I've ever been in my life." I took a friend of mine named Bill Milliken, who has been working with youth in a program called Communities in Schools for about 50 years, and he told the kids one night at dinner, "People often ask me what programs turn around a life." And I say, "I've never seen a program turn around a life. Only relationships turn around lives." And that's what's being built there. And what I've learned is that AOK is not, which is the name of our community, AOK DC, they just showed me a more emotive way of living and a way of connecting. And what I've learned is they are not unique. Such places are common. And I created this thing at the Aspen Institute called Weave, the Social Fabric Project. And we find these communities everywhere. And what we try to do is we lift them up, we illuminate them, we try to understand their values, and we try to ask everybody, how do we become a little more weaving? How do we weave the social fabric a little more in our lives, a little more around us? We're all on some continuum between social isolation and complete community. Wherever we happen to be on that continuum, we could all move a little two steps over to the right. We're sort of a moment like this, a moment of crisis, a moment of disconnection. It's like a silent Pearl Harbor. We're all called upon to do something extra. And so with Weave, we travel around the country meeting weavers and trying to learn how do they do it, what do they do, and how can we spread their gospel, the gospel they write with the book of their lives. And we would plop into a town, Wilkesboro, North Carolina, McCook, Nebraska. We'd find 75 of them immediately. I landed here yesterday. I went to Operation Breakthrough, a child care community center in downtown. I had lunch in this place called Thelma's Kitchen, I think it was called. Like, I met the people with the real disease. A young woman had come from Boston to serve the work with the homeless at Thelma's Kitchen, and she just had the weaving mentality. They're everywhere, these people. We met a woman, I described her earlier, named Aisha Butler, who was in a tough neighborhood in Chicago. Bullets were coming through her window. She had a 9-year-old daughter, so she was going to move out. And on the day of the moving vans came, she saw a little girl in a pink dress playing with broken bottles and tires in the empty lot across from her. And she said to her husband, "We're not leaving." And he was like, "Oh, Aisha." She said, "We're not going to be just another family who left this. We're not going to make this a neighborhood which has no two-parent families." And so she canceled the moving vans. She Googled volunteer in Englewood, and she now works at and runs the biggest community center in Englewood, and it's a community on the rebound. Shreveport, Louisiana, there's a guy named Mac McCarter. Mac is one of those guys, when you walk into a coffee shop with him, in the first hour, he's met everybody's name. In the second visit, he's made everybody his best friend. On the third visit, they're asking him to officiate their wedding. He's just like this warm, ebullient guy. And so he was working at a church. He's a pastor in a church in Texas. And he said, "No, I got to go home to my hometown of Shreveport. It's a divided city racially, economically. I'm called there. Society is a system of relationships," he read. And he said, "I've got to create a system of relationships in community in Shreveport." So he created this thing called Community Renewal. He's a white guy in his 70s now, drove into the poorest and most dangerous black neighborhood, and he was too scared to get out of the car. And he said, "Maybe I'll just do like a drive-by blessing." But he got out, joined the local church, over 3 years earned their trust, and then created an organization called Community Renewal International, which takes settlement houses and neighborhood home houses where you're a guest host family for the whole block. And he started spreading that. There are 300,000 people in Shreveport. 55,000 are volunteers in Mac's organization. Every block has a home, what they call a friendship house, where they weave the fabric of that town. You don't have to be this heroic. You just invite your neighbors over for dinner. But some of the people we met had horrible valleys in their lives. The most searing afternoon I spent was a woman with Sarah Atkins, named Sarah Atkins in Ohio, in Appalachian, Ohio. She was out volunteering or antiquing with her mom. She came home and found that her husband had killed their kids and himself. So she had suffered the worst thing that could happen. And she walked me through that day second by second. Now she runs a free pharmacy. She teaches at Ohio University. She has a foundation for moms who are suffering from violence. She said, "I grew from this experience because I was angry. I was going to fight back against what he had tried to do to me and make a difference in the world. He didn't kill me. My response to him was, whatever you meant to do to me, screw you, you're not going to do it." A lot of these weavers have what Richard Rohr calls a bright sadness. They're joyous people, but they've seen some of the depths of the world. And mostly what's impressed me is how they share a common value system. They can be in red America or blue America, young, old. They use the same words over and over again. They have a moral motivation. They're not driven by status, money, power, all the things economists said we're driven by. They just want to live in right relationship with each other and serve some ultimate good. They have vocational certitude. I've never met one who didn't, who said, oh, I'm just going to do this for a year and then I'll go to, back to accounting. No, they all say, this is why God put me on this earth. I'll die doing this. A lot of them have walkout experiences. They were part of corrupt systems that they had to leave in order to live what they considered a true life. They're somewheres, not anywheres. They've planted themselves down in a town and they devote themselves to that place. I met a guy in Youngstown, Ohio, just started his activism by holding up a sign that says, Defend Youngstown. They believe in radical hospitality. If you knock on the door, they will open it wider than you ever imagined. Radical mutuality. They hate the word charity. It's never me doing something for somebody more needy than me. We're all broken. We all work through this together. And they're all deeply relational. They're just geniuses at relationship. One of the most impressive people I met on this tour is a woman named Sarah Hamminger. And Sarah grew up in Indiana, and her dad, who was a deacon in the church, found out that the pastor was embezzling money. And instead of getting rid of the pastor, the community rallied around the pastor and ostracized Sarah's family. So for 8 years of her childhood, she was shunned by her community. At Christmas, at her grandmother's house, she and her sister had to be in a separate room. So she knew what isolation felt like. She was on a bus. She was getting a PhD in bioengineering at Johns Hopkins, and she was on a bus going by a place called Dunbar High School in Baltimore. She saw some lonely-looking kids, and her first thought was, I know exactly how they feel. And her second thought was, they're lonely, I'm lonely, maybe we can be friends. So she got a list of the 450 underperforming kids in the Baltimore school system and surrounded them with volunteers, a neighborhood of four volunteers called parents, four more called grandparents, 12 more called collaborators. So each kid has this fabric surrounding him. And because she's a technician, a technologist, she invented an app. When a kid comes near a volunteer with, and their phones are in proximity, they call that a touch. And she can track when the kids get touched, how often they get touched. She calls it the Fitbit of social relationships. And so she's created this web. It's not really about the children, though that's part of it. It's really about getting Baltimore knitted together for the sake of the children. And when the adults come into the kid's life, the kids who have been betrayed all their lives reject the relationship. They say, I don't want to be with you. You're going to hurt me. And the thread people, you're not allowed to leave thread. There's no departure. It's like family. And they just keep showing up. Unless you get a court order, they will keep knocking on your door. And Sarah says, it's identity changing for a kid after you've rejected somebody when somebody keeps showing up. And it's also identity changing for the adult who's been rejected. And she is transforming lives. So I described the values of the meritocracy. Weaver values are the opposite. They're different values. And these people have moved from one moral system to another moral system. And in the book, I use the device of First and Second Mountain to sort of describe the shift from one value system. The first value system is the value system of career and ego. That's what happens when you get out of college and you climb your first mountain. But then you go into the valley and the first mountain kind of seems trivial. And the second mountain is when you're giving back. The first mountain is building up the ego and defining the self. The second mountain is shedding the ego and losing the self. The first mountain is about acquisition. The second mountain is about contribution. The first mountain is elitist, you're climbing up. The second mountain is egalitarian, you're plowing yourself down and reaching down. And I've met so many people since the book came out who have had that valley and they've reoriented their lives. Sometimes they do it radically shifting how they live. I met a woman in New Orleans named Lisa Fitzpatrick who was a healthcare executive. She was in her car one day and she saw a 10, 11-year-old boy and they lifted something and it was a gun and they shot her in the face. It was a gang initiation ritual. They had to shoot somebody to get in the gang. She recovered and realized she was not the victim of this crime, she was collateral damage. The victims were the two little boys who had to shoot somebody to have a family. And so she quit her jobs and she now works on gang relations for the city of New Orleans. Some people change their lives, they go off to Tibet after the valley period. Most people stay in their lives, but they're a little different. They have a different attitude. And so I read about a guy named Luke, who's a hospital janitor. And Luke, his job was to clean rooms on a floor. And one of the rooms he cleaned was a kid who was in a coma that he wasn't coming out of. And his dad would sit there day after day, sitting vigil on his son. And one day, when Luke cleaned that kid's room, the dad was out getting a smoke. And Luke cleaned the room, but later in the day, the dad came up to him and said, "You didn't clean my kid's room." And Luke could have said, and this is the first mountain mentality, "My job is cleaning rooms." In that case, you say to the dad, "Yeah, I cleaned his room, but you were out getting a smoke." But you could say, and this is the second mountain mentality, "No, my job is not cleaning rooms. My job is comforting patients and their families." In which case, you would clean the room a second time so he could have the comfort of seeing you clean it. And that's what Luke did. And you're on a different system. The world says values independence, but you celebrate dependence. The world says celebrate autonomy, you celebrate relationship. The world says speak in an active voice, take charge. You speak in the middle voice, which is the voice of response. And you've entered a different universe and you're pointing toward different things. And the way I think about it is that people who are on the first mountain are shooting for happiness, and I'm all for happiness. You get a promotion, you get better at something, your team wins the Super Bowl, you're happy, you feel an expansion of self. But the people on the second mountain are not shooting for happiness, they're shooting for joy. And joy seems like happiness, but it's a little different. Happiness is the expansion of self, joy is the transcendence of self. When you're not really thinking about yourself, it's sometimes collective flow. It's sometimes you're dancing and you lose any sense of where you end and somebody else begins. And I collect these examples of joy. The novelist Zadie Smith was at a nightclub in London, and she was wandering about looking for her friends in her handbag when suddenly the hip-hop artist Q-Tip, A Tribe Called Quest, could be heard coming over the sound system. And she writes about what happened next. "A real thin man with enormous eyes reached across a sea of bodies for my hand. He kept asking me the same question over and over again, 'Are you feeling it?' I was. My ridiculous heels were killing me. I was terrified I might die. Yet I felt simultaneously overwhelmed with delight that Can I Kick It should happen to be playing at this precise moment in the history of the universe on the sound system and was now morphing into Smells Like Teen Spirit. I took the man's hand, the top of my head flew away. We danced, we gave ourselves up to joy." And we've all experienced that moment with friends where you just give yourself up to joy. Then there's a higher level of joy, which is emotional joy, the kind of transcendence we feel with our loved ones. Dorothy Day, one of my heroes, observed when she was pregnant that all the accounts of childbirth she'd ever read were written by men. And so she decided, "I'm gonna write one." And she wrote one 40 minutes after the birth of her daughter. And part of it is about the pain of childbirth. This was back in the 20s. But part of it is about what happened at the end. She wrote, "If I had written the greatest book, composed the greatest symphony, or created carved the most exquisite figure, I could not have felt the more exalted creator than I did when they placed my child in my arms. No human creature could receive or contain so vast a flood of love and joy as I felt after the birth of my child. With that came the need to worship and to adore." And that joyful moment transformed her life. She became a Catholic and then served the next 60 years serving the poor and living with the poor. Then there's a higher level, which we'd call spiritual joy, when you sense contact with something that seems infinite and boundless. I have a friend who's a poet in Yale, a very great poet and a very great writer named Christian Wiman. And when you ever ask Chris about his early life, he's always in some different city, and he's always there because there's some woman he's chasing there. It's like, "Why'd you live in Buffalo?" "Oh, there was a woman there." "Why'd you live in Cincinnati?" "Oh, there was a woman there." So he was in Prague because there was a woman there. And he was writing his poetry in the apartment kitchen table. And a falcon lands on the windowsill on the other side of the glass. And he looks at it, and he's struck by its beauty. It's scanning the streetscape, and he sees its beauty. And such a beautiful bird. So he calls his girlfriend. "Come here, you gotta see this." She comes out wrapped in a towel in the shower, dripping wet, and they stare at this bird. And then the bird turns its eyes and locks eyes with Wyman. And Wyman wrote that as he locked eyes in with the bird, it seemed to be staring into centuries. Something crumbled inside. And it's somehow you're staring at transcendence. And his girlfriend, who understood the power of the moment, said, make a wish. And he wrote a poem about it, and it includes the stanza, and for a long moment I'm still in. I wished and I wished and I wished and I wished that the moment would not end. And just like that, it vanished. And that's moments of joy. And so that described moments of joy, but the highest level is not when joy was just a moment, it's when joy is an outlook. It's a permanent part of somebody's personality. I don't know about you, about every 30 days, I meet someone who just radiates joy. There's a guy I know in DC named Father Ray East, Catholic priest. When he holds up the Eucharist, it's like, and it's joy personified. Through my weave work at the Aspen Project, I get to work with Yo-Yo Ma. And that guy just radiates joy. It's like he'd never met a human being before. And when you meet him, he's like, wow, a human being, these things are so cool. And then look, there's another one and another one. He's like permanently delighted. I once was seated next to the Dalai Lama at a Washington function. And he didn't say anything profound to me, which was a disappointment. But he laughs for no apparent reason. He just starts laughing. And I was sitting next to him, and I want to be polite, so I would laugh, and then he would laugh, and I would laugh. I tried to insert a joke, so just to justify the laughter. But I had nothing to say to the guy, so I finally, he has this little canvas Dalai Lama bag. So I say, you got any candy in your bag? So he starts pulling all the stuff out of the bag, and it's basically everything you get on the first class cabin of an international flight. It's like the little eye patches and ear things, little razor, but he had a Toblerone bar in there. But he radiates joy. And those who radiate joy have hit the peak of the second mountain. They've truly taken themselves out of the picture, and they live their life as pure gift. And we are in a world of pain in some parts of our society, but there's also that promise beckoning us forward. And it's the life God wants us to lead. And even if we don't get there, if we point ourselves toward joy, we'll be headed in the right direction. Thank you.
Go ahead and have a seat, and we are going to take a few moments just to have a little conversation. Hold on a second. Guys, we need the water. There we go. So that was great, and some of us have had the privilege of listening to David twice today, and two really remarkable talks. And I want to just ask a few questions based upon your book and upon what you've said here today. And I want to mention, first of all, you give a wonderful outline after you start off talking about the two mountains, which you've helped us understand, and you talk about the four commitments, and you've talked about them, but you've sort of wound them together with stories. So why don't you mention specifically the four commitments and their connection to the second mountain?
So on the first mountain, you're sort of keeping your options open. On the second mountain, you're committing. And a commitment to me, and you're really tying yourself down, and you're making promises to that thing. And so a commitment is falling in love with something and then building a structure of behavior around it for those moments when love falters. So Jews love their God, but they keep kosher just in case. And so, in my view, most of us in the course of our lives make four big commitments, not all of us, but up to four, to a spouse and family, to a community, to a philosophy and faith, and to a vocation. And the quality of your life and the quality of your service will be defined by how well you choose and then live up to those commitments. And the book really started as I was teaching college kids. And I said, listen, you're going to get to college in the next 15 years. You're going to have to make these big choices. Let's think about how you do it. Let's think about the difference between a vocation and just a career, between a covenantal marriage and just a regular marriage. So the one they could not get their heads around was marriage. They were loved talking about vocation. They loved talking about community. But they were 21, 22. They said, marriage is a box that'll come in the mail when I'm 35. I said, it's the most important decision you're going to make in your life. If you have a bad marriage and a great career, you'll be unhappy. If you have a great marriage and a bad career, you'll be happy. So think about this. It was something that belief in marriage is down among the young. And I just tried to describe to them how it works, how to choose a marriage partner, what kind of love to look for. There are three ways of looking at marriage, just quickly. There's the psychological lens. First, when you think about getting married, most of us are too old for this now, but there's a lot of research on what to look for. And the short answer is go with kindness and avoid neuroticism. Kindness doesn't seem that great, not that exciting, really useful in a marriage. The second lens is the emotional lens. What kind of love for you do you have for this person? There are three kinds of love. There's philia, which is friendship. There's eros, which is love, which is passion. And then there's agape, which is selfless admiration. And you better have all three. If you just have just philia, you've just got a friendship. If you just got eros, you've just got a fling. Try to have all three. And then finally, the moral lens. Love comes and goes, admiration is pretty stable. If you lose respect for your marital partner, then you've got a real problem. And so marry someone you could admire and respect. So these are the kinds of things I would tell my students, and they'll get to it in 30 years. When you're a teacher, you're pouring into your students more than they're ready to take in. So you're just trying to plant some seeds.
That's good. You talk about in the book the school you're going to build together. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, that marriage is an educational process. Somebody likened it famously to a gem tumbler, where you bounce around together until you get a little shinier. And so you're just learning stuff. And actually, Tim Keller and Kathy Keller wrote one of the best books ever on marriage called The Meaning of Marriage. And they have a good formulation that you marry this person and you decide this is the most perfect, wonderful person on the face of the earth. And then 6 months or 2 years in, you come to this realization, that person is actually kind of selfish. And as that person, as you're making that realization about her, she's making it about you. And so at that moment, you can decide to either have a truce marriage, which case you'll avoid your imperfections, or a covenantal marriage, where you'll say, well, she may be selfish, but my selfishness is the only one I can really control. And he says, if you have two people who decide their own selfishness is the real problem here, you have the makings of a good marriage. And the interesting thing about marriage, it's not so big, it's all in the little moments. There's a researcher, a team named the Gottmans, who said in every marriage, there are bids. I make a bid toward you. I say, look at the beautiful bird outside the window. And you can either make a way bid, which you say, I'm reading the paper, don't bother me. A neutral bid, you just ignore. And a toward bid, which you say, oh yeah, that is a beautiful bird. This is just a little encounter. And the marriages that survive have 5 toward bids for every away bid. And the Gottmans can take a 10-minute video of a couple having a conversation, and they can tell with 90-some-odd% accuracy who's going to divorce and who's not. And what they're looking for is any sign of contempt. And so these are just the small little makings of a marriage. Now, actually, one of my friends in D.C., she was in a new marriage, and she had a brawling fight with her husband. And afterwards, they sort of made up, and they went to CVS. And they were shopping, and then they went to the cashier, and they bought their stuff, and they started asking about the neighborhood and stuff like that. And she was feeling very teary and fragile from this fight. And the cashier said to her, you know, you two are really good together. And it was what she needed to hear at that moment. And she said, that's what angels look like.
Let's talk a little bit more about vocation and the difference between vocation and career. And you also have a little subchapter in your book on vampire problems. I think it's related to this.
Yeah. So the vampire problem is not my formulation. It's a philosopher's formulation. She said, imagine if I came to you and I said, would you like to become a vampire? You could fly around at night. You'd have all these great powers. You wouldn't have to drink human blood. You could drink cow blood. It would be awesome. And you'd live forever. And The problem is, you as a human self don't know what it feels like to be a vampire self, because this kind of choice is a transformational choice. So you have no information about what the future self as a vampire will feel or look like, or what you'll want, or whether it's a good choice or not. And her point is that we make vampire choices all the time. These are choices that change who you are. When you decide to get married, that's a vampire choice. When you decide to have kids, kids will change who you are. When you enter the Marine Corps, you have no idea what you're doing, because your future Marine Corps self will be a very different human being. And so we're constantly bombarded by these choices where we have no factual data to go on. And so you just have to feel your way into them aesthetically, and then you just have, choosing is not only choosing, choosing is re-choosing the choice you already chose. A lot of our life is just re-choosing those choices. And so these are the choices that kids have to make, and they're terrified in the face of them.
You try to get as much information as you can, but at some point there's a step of faith, right? You're taking some kind of leap of faith.
You're taking a total leap. And there are some things you can do, like before you make the choice, you can apply the 10-10-10 rule. How will this decision feel in 10 minutes, 10 hours, and 10 months? That helps you think about short-term pain versus long-term gain. And scientifically, if you're buying a house, how do you know when to choose the house you love? The algorithmic answer is go to see 17 houses and then pick the next house that's better than those 17. That way you know you've sampled the market. But you, so there's a scientific way to sort of help yourself a little, but ultimately it's a surrender to something. And ultimately it's like falling in love. It is a leap.
So when you think about vocation, the idea vocare, to call, it's a calling. Say a little more about this idea of calling.
Yeah, I think about Viktor Frankl in this case. So he went around and said the things that we say to a lot of our college students: what do I want from life? And so he was a psychologist or psychiatrist in Austria in the 1930s, and he was sent to a concentration camp. And when he was at the camp, he realized that the question, what do I want from life, is the wrong question. The right question is, what is life asking of me? What are my circumstances asking me to do? What problem is in front of me that I'm uniquely equipped to solve? And so we're called by the circumstances of our life. And he was a psychiatrist in Auschwitz. So he said, I'm supposed to study suffering. Suffering did not want to be a problem upon which he turned his back. So he did a little study initially, realizing that some people at Auschwitz died almost immediately, and some people lived for years. What was the difference? The people who lived had some commitment and some conversation with things outside the camp. There was a book they were working on. There was a wife or children they were going to go back to. And they had this spiritual transformation. So he met a young woman who was dying in the infirmary, and she said, I'm lucky life has hit me this hard. And he said, oh, and she said, before I did not value spiritual things. And he said, well, what do you need? What can I help you? And she said, well, I need a friend. I only have one friend in this infirmary, and it's the tree outside my window. Mm. And she said, I always talk to this tree. And he said, does the tree ever talk back to you? And she said, yes. He says, what does it say? She said, the tree tells me, I am life, I am life, I'm eternal life. Mm. And so she had discovered faith in that moment, and there was a calmness about her.
So let's talk about, as we transition that, or good transition to, your own faith. And so how would you characterize your spiritual journey across the course of your life and what's happened in the last 5 years or so?
Yeah. So this is a long story, but I'll make it as short as possible. I grew up in a Jewish home, but it was in New York City, Lower East Side. And if you grew up in my Jewish culture, there was a saying, and we tried to assimilate to be, so no one would think we were Jewish, and we tried to adopt very English manners. And the phrase was, think Yiddish, act British. So all these Jewish families, a generation above mine, gave their kids, and especially the boys, these very English names, so people would think they were English. And they were names like Sidney, Milton, Lionel, Irving. And within 5 years, everybody thought of them as Jewish names, so it didn't really work. But my parents sent me to a place called Grace Church School. And I was part of what I call the All Jews Boys Davening Choir at Grace. We were about like 30% Jewish in the choir, and to square it with our religion, we wouldn't sing the word Jesus. And so the volume would drop down and then come back up after. And so I was raised with the Jewish story, which is an Exodus story, a story of peoplehood. But I was also, through this school and then through a church camp I went to for 15 years, I was raised with the Christian story. And I had these dual narratives running through my head through much of my life, but it didn't really matter because I didn't believe in God anyway. So it was just like two cultural things. And then I would say gradually life became more enchanted than my secular categories could explain. And I had certain experiences. I saw beauty. I mean, reading Dorothy Day, reading Augustine, you see a moral beauty that is hard to explain in this world. And I encountered that beauty. About 15 years ago, I heard the name John Stott, who I hope you all know. He's a prominent English evangelical preacher and teacher. And I said, who is John Stott? And I called up a friend of mine, and he said, John Stott, if evangelicals had a pope, John Stott would be the pope. And so I wrote a column in the New York Times called Who is John Stott? Because John Stott's name had never appeared in the New York Times. And I was struck by seeing a Christian who was very different than anybody I'd ever know, and someone I'd kind of like to be. Several months later, Stott comes to Washington, and he takes me out to lunch, and he hammers me on my faith. He said, there was something moving in you when you wrote that column. What is your faith? What is your journey? And he hammered me hard over lunch, and I was not ready to receive that yet. But it kept lingering in my mind. It kept having these experiences. And then I just had a whole series of transcendent experiences. I was up a place called American Lake in Colorado, and I had a little book of Puritan prayers, High and Holy, Meek and Lowly. And I was up at the top of a mountain, and the high and holy mountains were there, and this little badger-type creature sort of walked across my feet. And I started reading the poem, and I can't remember it all now, but it fit my surroundings. And I had a sense of being held. And I often say I experienced grace before I experienced God. And it doesn't make any sense, but that's how it felt. Mm-hmm. And so I began going on this journey, and suddenly these two stories rattling in my head seemed true. And so I started talking to people, and people were praying for me. And I learned when you're on a spiritual journey, people hand you books. And so within a couple months, I had 800 books of theology. Only 300 of which were different versions of Mere Christianity by C.S. Lewis. and I just kept going, and I had a lot of teachers. And I started listening to Hillsong. And it happened so gradually. One of the books that was key to me was called Sheldon Van Auken, Severe Mercy. And his wife, Davy, converted just a spiritual blossoming. And he took it very differently. He took it as an intellectual exercise. Faith hits people in different ways. And it just, over the years, it just gradually grew. And the way I describe it in the book, it was like being on a train, and suddenly you're just sitting with all the people you've been sitting with. It seems very stable. But you look out the window and you realize there's a lot of ground behind you. And you've crossed across some boundary, some frontier, and you're not an atheist anymore, you're not even agnostic. God's presence seems real in your life. And when Jesus sits down next to you and asks you to call. That didn't happen. No, I'm kidding about that. Didn't happen to me. Happens to other people, but nothing like that happened to me. But, you know, I crossed the boundary. And it's still, believe me, the most fragile and ongoing journey. But I don't know what to say. All I could say is I'm about to drop a name, but I hope it's for a point. I've done the Oprah show twice. One was 5 years ago, and one was about 3 months ago. And all these things happened in the interim. And she said to me after our taping, I've never seen anybody change so much. Mm. You were blocked before. Mm. And that's the work of, that's not my work, that's somebody else's work.
Yeah. So as you would, if you were, yeah. your story, I've heard you tell it several times, and I'm so reminded of C.S. Lewis, who got on the bus and he wasn't a Christian, and he got off the bus and he was, and but yet it was all this stuff that was happening for some time before that, and the Holy Spirit's work in unblocking you or transforming all of us. If you're a follower of Christ, you're praying for that Holy Spirit to be transforming you.
Yeah. And I must say, I feel more Jewish than ever before.
Yeah.
And I sometimes resent, frankly, the way this Jewish rabbi, how we've built over the centuries a big bifurcation between these two traditions, yes, as both of them try to define themselves against the other. And no offense, but he was a brown-skinned guy. Yeah. We have this Aaron, like this white Protestant Jesus, but he was probably a guy looked like me, like a short, dumpy, balding Jewish guy. and you know,
he's actually only 5'4". You just can't tell.
But
I do want to say something about that, though, because if you look at his face, the way it's colored, you can't tell from down here. It didn't come across so well, but it's olive and red and yellow and green and purple are the colors that make up his face, because we were aiming to say that Jesus wasn't a white North American guy.
I was at my church, the pastor come in to talk about the Africans, the black people who are in the Bible. And I'm sitting listening to that sermon as he talks about, like, who are the black people in the Bible. I remember thinking, who are the white people in the Bible?
Yeah. That's right.
You know this better than I could think of, like, Pontius Pilate was probably white, but that's the only one.
That's probably right. So I want to wrap it up with this. So how would you describe who Jesus is to you? What would you say about, and if you were explaining to someone else, you know, this is who, well, you are, you're explaining to all these people. This is my experience of Jesus. This is who he is as I see him in my mind.
Yeah, so he's the moral sublime. And there's a quote in the book, and to me that, I say I believe in the Jewish story, but I can't unread Matthew. And in Matthew, you get the beatitudinal are not just a bunch of other words. They're a part of some sacred thing from the universe that has come down to us. And so it is just transcendent beauty, moral beauty. And some people, I was just reading this great biography of Dostoevsky, and I was comforted because he is not a resurrection Christian, but more a beatitudinal Christian. That's just the thing that touched him most. And so I can't, when you read that and you experience the life and teaching of Jesus, you can't not want to think that is the end here. And so to me, it's not a God. Some people talk about a God who keeps promises, some a God who saves, and those are all true. But to me, it's a God of moral beauty. Mm. And that's what I see there.
Yes, thank you. So I want to give an invitation while you're sitting here, and then I'm going to escort you out and let people come and greet you and pick up a couple of your books. But if you're here and you are not here for Leadership Institute and you're not a Resurrection member and you live in Kansas City and you don't have a church home, I'd like to invite you to come back. Because every Sunday, this is what we do, is we try to figure out who is Jesus. And in what way does he call us to live lives that are lives of moral character, moral courage, and to live into these four commitments that you've talked about? In the stained glass window that you see up here, Jesus has his hands outstretched, and part of what he's saying as you walk in the room is he's saying, come to me. Wherever you are, whoever you are, come to me, and I'll welcome you. And then at the end of every worship service, I often will have people look up at the window again and just say, you know what Jesus is saying now? Get out of here and make a difference. Like, get out of here and go change the world. Get out of here and spread kindness and beauty and love and courage. And so if you're here and you don't have a church family, we'd like to invite you to come back. This weekend, we're preaching through the Ten Commandments. We're asking, what did Jesus have to say about the commandment, do not kill? And you had a lot to say about that, that was positive. It wasn't just a do not kill, but it had, how do you positively live the opposite of that? And that's what we're going to talk about this weekend, so I hope you'll come back.
Can I offer one way to do good in the world?
Yeah, please.
So I don't know if they're still out there, but there are cards for our Weaver organization. If you go to the website, weareweavers.org, we'd love to have your help and contribution in trying to figure out ways to weave the social fabric back together, weareweavers.org.
So check that out, Uyghur Weavers, and there's information out there in the Narthex. And also, if you're those of you who are Resurrection folks, this has been fun for me to get to interview you. A couple of years ago, 3 years ago, I first met David Brooks at the Aspen Ideas Festival, where he interviewed me. I was the nobody that nobody at Aspen knew or heard about, but they did want to come hear him. And so he interviewed me about a book called Seeing Gray in a World of Black and White. And it's online, too. So if you check David Brooks, Adam Hamilton, Seeing Gray, or Aspen Ideas Festival, you'll find it out there, too. All right, we're going to have a closing prayer, and then I'm going to ask, let's see. Steve Harper, would you mind escorting David out I'm giving the benediction. I'm going to have you ask him right now. Would you join me in thanking David Brooks for being with us today? All right, while they're heading outside, I'm going to hang with you, have you hang here for just a second so they have a chance to get out the door before you do. And I want to invite you, those of you who are here for the Leadership Institute, be here first thing tomorrow morning. We got a really important 4 hours, 8 o'clock sharp. Be here at about 7:55, and we're going to get to the parking lot a little before that so you can get inside. And we're going to have an awesome crescendo to the Leadership Institute tomorrow, so we want you to be sure to be here. 8 o'clock, we finish up about 12:20 tomorrow. And send you on your way. Would you bow now for the benediction? And as we leave this place, may we go forth as people who long to walk through the valley to discover the second mountain, who live lives of beauty and goodness and courage, faith and love. And may God's love and mercy fill you with his peace today and always, in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. God bless you. Have a great night.